It's amazing to be standing here now, finally, after nearly 5 years of planning and designing and then construction. But to be standing here finally in the completed swamp forest is truly amazing. It's an incredible habitat we've created. You can probably tell it's really hot in here. I'm feeling the heat, and that's really what we built this dome for, to have a multi-sensory, immersive experience, to really feel the warmth and the heat and the humidity, even the rainfall and the smells and sounds of the rainforest.
So the swamp forest was really a dream come true in the middle of the Southeast Asia jungle tract. My name's Becca Hansen, and I'm a landscape architect. Well, the vision for the swamp forest was always to create this incredible, humid, light-filled, plant-filled space that had the Sundagarial as the prime actor, the hero, if you will, but also representing the biodiversity of the Southeast Asian swamp forest regions, streams and waterways. The experience that we created was one with a lot of water that then served the needs of the animals for both deep water, shallow water, getting in front of house with the visitors, getting back of house where they could receive care from the staff. This was a conservative look at things, but we've been able to go way beyond this. And I think when the crocodiles get in there, they will go, oh my goodness, this is better than a swamp forest.
Follow me. As you come in, you are encouraged gently down deep into the heart of the swamp forest, into this beautifully arched piece of acrylic, which is magnificent in itself, and into the underwater views of sort of nose to nose of this incredible crocodilian, which will be wreathed by all these beautiful fish. Honestly, I'm feeling incredibly excited to be a part of the team that delivers this experience. I just can't wait to try and recreate the wild within this dome.
So we'll just take a look up at the beautiful dome structure that will be forming the roof. Currently all these ribs are joined by blue netting, and that's just safety precautions. We'll walk to the threshold. We can see the structure of the complex crocodile pools that are being developed. You can see the complexity and the amount of steel that's required to create these organic complex shapes. The Tamistema crocodile is a denizen really of the shallow swampy rivers of Southeast Asia. And they love shallow water, they love undercut banks where they can hide underneath and get a little bit of a roof over their head. So these two ponds here, the one where the guys are working is the larger of what is a one continuous pond, but there's actually a hidden divider in the middle. So we can keep our big predatory arowana on one side, but allow the small fish to move around as they see fit, which is pretty cool. These are the acrylic windows, which will actually give us the underwater viewing of the crocodiles and the fish. It's 6.7 meters by 3.3 meters, and it's 8 centimeters thick. So we're aiming for around 28 degrees centigrade. So that's what we want, warm, tropical environment. And that's a year-round thing. So we've got a number of systems for doing that. First and foremost, all around the perimeter of this enclosure will be some very subtle but very important radiators, giant radiators filled with hot water that will just subtly provide convection heating for the environment. The dome is an insulator from the cold in the cold weather, but it also is a magnifying glass. Therefore, it's going to amplify the heat of the sun. We also have, if you look up at the top of the dome, you can see these four rectangular panels. And all around the top of the concrete wall, you can see the gap between the concrete and the ribs of the roof. We have a whole circuit of louvers. And those louvers are thermostatic control to open or close. So if it's really hot, the roof opens, the hot air wants to escape. It can't escape because you can't cause a vacuum. You open the louvers, cool air comes in from the walls, and you create a gentle cooling chimney effect. Because of the aquatic nature of the animals, it has been and continues to be a huge challenge, but at the same time, incredibly exciting because, you know, you really start to feel it now.
Good morning. An exciting day for Auckland Zoo and certainly the ectotherm keepers here. The roof has gone on our swamp forest tropical dome. So what is happening now? We've got a couple of spider men on one of the supporting arches of the dome. They're basically being stretched and locked into place with these clips which run the entire length of the ribs of the dome. So you'll occasionally see basically a rubber hammer being put into use. The cool thing about this fabric, which was developed for the aeronautics industry, is that it's incredibly strong. It's actually called ETFE, but also lets through ultraviolet light of a certain spectrum, which is brilliantly beneficial for the animals that are going in there. They look pretty flat from this aspect, but actually they're very, very gently being kept kind of full of air to give insulation throughout the building. It's a lid on our environment, so all very important. Well, you can start to see just the edges of the umbilical sort of cord going in, which basically supply the air to each of these pillows. It's an incredible achievement to get to this stage for all those who are involved, because nothing is off the shelf. Everything has to be specially made. This building, it hopes to deliver not only the best functionality for the keepers, but first and foremost, it's delivering what the animals need first.
It's a big day here for us on the Swamp Forest project. And here you'll see, this is a big ficus. This is going to become our major dominant focal tree in the dome. It's a good sized specimen now, and it's just been collected today and dug out with this specialist device. And it's just on its way to be planted now, right in the middle of the dome. We're just preparing the root ball. As you can see, the roots are actually fairly shallow. This guy here, he's just now creating the soil platform that the ficus is going to sit on. And the reason we need to get that tree in now is because this barrier here that you can see, this needs to be completed. And this goes around this central area, which becomes a raised planted area, part of the forest. So we've got to put the tree in before we build that. Crop around here and the choke's here. Yeah. This is the moment of truth. See what happens when we pick the tree up.
Now's the hardest part. So we've used the forklift to bring it to the doorway on the outside, and now the crane is positioning himself to take the weight from the inside. This tree should lean over more on an angle, and we should just be able to drag it through. Beautiful.
Well, I think we just about got it in. That's what you call a tight fit. Ficus tree is in the dome. It's still hanging in there. It's currently suspended more or less where it's going to be living. But yeah, it's in. Awesome. Result.
Wow. It's really filling up fast, isn't it? Goodness me, it all makes sense now, doesn't it? Fantastic. You can see that we have viewing into one of the deeper areas, but as the water rises, it will create a really lovely shallow. And as we move round, you'll feel that we descend into this habitat more and more. So we'll move down into this very awe-inspiring window where you get this incredible expansive view. This is the deepest underwater viewing where I'm stood, pretty much. And the water will be roughly here. So behind me now, submerged as the water rises, is a large trunk of swamp kauri. It's the furnishings that make a home, right? And that's exactly what we hope to achieve. It's just about variety. You've got to give animals choice. And that is what we have tried to do here. And goodness me, there's choice everywhere. We're looking at eventually around 200,000 litres of rainwater that's been harvested around the Auckland Zoo site.
This magnificent space is our life support room. This is kind of the brains as well as the heart of the building. What you can see in front of you is this extraordinary framework and ducting and plumbing is the mechanical filtration and biological. We've got the heating system for both the water supply for the ponds, but also the heating for the dome itself. To my right here, we've got the pump that keeps our amazing ETFE roof inflated. So it's an incredibly complicated space, and this therefore provides really all the climate, the terrestrial and the aquatic climate of the tropics.
Standing in the entry and I'm being rained on, just a gentle mist coming in, so really setting the stage for the whole of the tropical dome, if you will. And as we come around here, you can see some of the plants that are going to be planted in the wall. The ficus tree here will grow up and over. We've got mangoes. You know, arriving back here after over 2 years of being gone is a little like awakening from a dream. And it was a very vivid dream, but suddenly your eyes are wide open and you're going, I remember drawing this stuff. I remember talking about this stuff in construction meetings. And it's all built. If you did a cutaway in a tannin-rich swamp forest, this is what you might encounter. So you really begin to get the feeling of that peat and all of the roots growing out and into the water. This again will feel like it's just in this middle of this rich and glowing space. And then we might have a final shower here and you're off and on your journey down to otters.
I think probably amongst all the fish in the dome, all of which have been an epic effort to get here, the Asian arowana perhaps epitomised the planning that goes into a new habitat like this. So these Asian arowana, they were born and bred in a specialist facility in Singapore. We brought them to New Zealand 4 years ago when they were just this long. And we've had them set up in a quarantine and rearing facility for the last 4 years, knowing that we were building this habitat and we wanted to have some near adult fish. So it's been a huge logistical and practical challenge. I think probably it culminated when we moved the arowana from their home for the last 4 years into this new facility. The best way to move fish is in effectively plastic bags, but you need strong plastic bags to make sure these fish don't panic and swim straight through them. And ultimately transferred all six of them without any incident. But it was a challenging and somewhat nervous time, but we rose to the challenge, and what magnificent fish they are. Another easy day's work.
Well done.
Well done. Well done. Well done.
My name's Julie, so I'm one of the ectotherm keepers here. I was really lucky to get to go to Denmark and actually work with the sundagarrels before they came back to New Zealand. So we've got Malu and Sumpit, two females. Luckily, when I was over there, I wasn't in charge of catching them up. I hadn't worked with them before, so it was the team at the Crocodile Zoo who did all the hard work in terms of catching them and getting them into the crates. The whole process of them coming back to New Zealand on the plane, there's quite a lot of steps that go into that. So they get unloaded at the airport and then they get transported here and they have to go straight into an international quarantine. So they would have spent about a month in there, and eventually we saw them starting to relax and they were coming out and basking and not just hiding in the water. So it was really good for us to be able to track that change in behaviour as they became more comfortable in the offshore pool.
This is the moment.
Swamp forest is all about biodiversity and in fact biomass, about the abundance, the prevalence of life in a rainforest. We're absolutely covered in plants, everything has got plants growing on it, and there are more than 100 species of plants in here and 15 or 16 species of fish that are distributed around the swamp forest in different water bodies. Some of them are big swirling shoals and masses of small fish, and others are slightly larger fish, to really emphasise the abundance of life in a rainforest. Of course, the icing on the cake is our amazing Sunday gharial.
So I walk through the doors and then I come in and there's like this wave of heat. It makes me feel exciting. To step into a rainforest in the middle of like Auckland City is really cool. I really, really like animals. I'm super into them. Gharials in Auckland Zoo, that's amazing. Like, yeah.
It makes me feel excited because you get to like hear the siamangs and at the same time see all this beautiful fish. It's just so amazing.
The experience of it is unlike anything else in the zoo. It's an incredibly immersive space. Being surrounded by all of the beautiful plants, and the experience of the river kind of wrapping around you as you walk through, and it's very different from anything else. Just really special to see it through the eyes of our kids as well.
I think we really have delivered a bespoke, really sort of world-class and somewhat unique facility to exhibit incredible crocodiles amongst the diversity of fish and plants in a way that no one really else has done before. And the tropics are among our most threatened habitat types. They're the most biodiverse parts of the world. We rely on them for our oxygen, we rely on them for our life, really. And we really want people to know about, care about, and feel that it's important to preserve the tropics. And so if you don't go and appreciate it for yourself, you can at least come to Auckland Zoo, visit our tropical swamp forest here, and get a sense of what it's really like, and hopefully a bit of an understanding and a passion for and a care for the absolute critical ecosystems that tropical forests are, and why it's so important to do whatever you can, whether it's sustainable timber, whether it's sustainable palm oil in the products that you buy, whether it's donating to NGOs and conservation organisations like Auckland Zoo, but doing whatever you can to preserve the rainforests and the tropical environments of the world as part of saving the earth and getting it through these ecological crises that we're currently facing.